Merry Christmas. Welcome to Red Cedar Church. Why don't you guys stand to your feet? We are so glad that you're worshiping with us tonight. And we are going to just bring in this Christmas season, singing this song, Go Tell It on the Mountains. Let's sing this while shepherds kept.
While shepherds kept.
Guys can go ahead and have a seat. I just want to thank you guys for joining us today. If you don't know me, my name is Parker. I'm the youth director here at Red Cedar. If you are new today or if you are visiting, we just want to say welcome. We are glad that you are here today to celebrate the birth of Jesus. It's going to be such a great night as we celebrate that. Right now, I want to invite you. There's a Connect card in the seat back in front of you. It looks something like this. If you want to go ahead and grab that and fill that out, we would love to connect with you. You can put your contact info on there. You can put praises and prayer requests that we would love to follow up with you about. And if it is your first time here, you can take that to the Full Life desk in the lobby, and we would love to give you a gift as a thank you for joining us. I also wanted to welcome our Ladysmith campus. We are so glad that you are joining us for this service tonight. Right now, we are going to transition into our time of worship through giving. And if you are visiting today, please don't feel obligated to give. But if you're a part of our Red Cedar family, we want to invite you to give. As we invite the ushers forward, you can give in a couple different ways. You can give in the baskets as they're being passed in the house. You can give online on our website or on the Red Cedar Church app. Or if you're at Ladysmith, you can give in the back of the room. Would you all join me in praying over our offering today? Father, thank you for this day and for this time. And Lord, thank you for your generosity and the generous gift that you gave us that is your Son. And Lord, I pray that as we give back to you, we can trust you with this gift and trust that you are going to multiply it for what you have planned. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. At this time, as they're passing the baskets, there's a couple things that we want to make sure you don't miss out on. Next weekend, we are going to be having some online-only New Year's Eve and New Year's services. That's going to be the 31st at 6:30 and the 1st at 11 a.m. Those are going to be on our Facebook, YouTube, and on the Red Cedar website, so you're not going to want to miss out on those next weekend. And then the following weekend, we're going to be kicking off our new series called Transforming. Now, I'm really excited for this series because it's all about the transforming power that God has in our lives. And we're going to hear some great testimonies about how that power has been at work in the lives of people here at Red Cedar. So you're not going to want to miss out on that. Here in just a couple moments, we're going to continue to worship together.
Yep, like Parker said, we're going to sing this song, King of Kings. It's all about the gospel story of how Jesus came down to earth as a baby, lived his life, died, and rose again, and then the Holy Spirit came to be with us. So let's sing this.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without life, till from heaven you came running. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and prophet, to Savior came the word from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God
by his blood and in his name, in his grace.
right now to speak to each and every one of us. Wherever we're at, we are just coming together, and we invite you to move and have your way in this place. Thank you.
Christmas to you. You may have a seat. My name is Wes. For those of you who do not know me, I want you to know that I love you. More importantly, I want you to know that God loves you. He has a message for you tonight about unwrapping his presence. With that being said, would you pray with me? Our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks on this Christmas. We give you thanks that your Son is the light of the world. We worship you through song, through prayer, through the preaching of your word, because you have changed our lives. And not only did you come to this world, you come to walk beside us. You come to live with us. You come and give us the promises that you will never leave us nor forsake us. Father, we love you and we give you thanks. Help us to unwrap the presents of Christmas. In your name we pray, amen. So let me ask you a question. What is the best Christmas present you have ever received? You personally, what was the best gift that you can ever remember receiving? For me, it was easy. When I was a little bit more poor, I used to have on Fridays, I would go visit Bass Pro Shop on Fridays in Ohio, and I would hit Chick-fil-A or the Old Spaghetti Factory, and then I would go through Bass Pro Shop and do this little routine, but then I would make my way, and I would stare at these poles I could not afford, and I would just look at them, and I never really thought much about them. I was surprised about the cost of these poles, and I wondered why they were so special, and I would stare at them. Well, about 2-3 years into Kelly and I being together, she bought me one of those poles, and she totally surprised me. I didn't even notice that she noticed me looking at it, but I remember she totally got me, and I was shocked, and I was just so pumped to get that fishing pole. Let me ask you another question. What is the best gift you have ever given to someone else? For me, I bought my friend a shotgun when he graduated from college. I was really pumped for him, asked him what he wanted. He wanted a shotgun to go hunting, so we got him a shotgun, and that was a really big deal for me to give that to him. Let me ask you another question. What if you had unlimited resources? What would you buy someone, and whom would you buy it for? What if money was no problem? What would you buy, and who would you buy it for? That's easy for me. I would buy my wife with tons of puppies. I would give her tons of flowers. And then I would hire a caretaker to take care of it all so I didn't have to do any chores with this added pleasure. And I would let her just run around with puppies and flowers all day. And my life would be abundantly great. Here's the message of Christmas for you. God does have unlimited resources. And God decided with his unlimited resources to give you his Son so that you could experience the very gift of Christmas. And in order to show you that, I want to show you a very familiar scripture. And we're going to look at this scripture, and it really gives us the flavor of Christmas, the very essence of who God is and what he's trying to accomplish on Christmas. It's John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Let's just continue to stare at the scripture for a moment. We see God. He's the greatest lover of all time. He so loved the world in its deepest essence from him to you. He's not just loved you, he really loved you. To whom did he give this gift to? It's the biggest gift that has ever been given. It's been given to the entire world. Whom did he give? His one and only begotten Son. This is the greatest gift that has been ever given because he loved us so much by the greatest gift giver. And whoever believes, it's the greatest simplicity. It's not that you have to earn it, that he just wants to give it to you because that's who our God is. He wants you to have a relationship with him. He wants you to enjoy his love so that we shall not perish, the greatest deliverance. And what does he want to give you instead of you perishing or dying? He wants to give you eternal life. This is the joy of Christmas. This is the hope of Christmas. But tonight, I want to go back to the night that Christ was born. And I want you to see exactly how this gift was given, and then we'll walk through that so we can enjoy unwrapping this presence together. Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through 25, about Christ coming into this world as the child of God. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law. and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace. He had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the same name, Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate the marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. In that passage, we hear two promises. One, give him the name Jesus, he will forgive the sins of his people. So we know that Christmas is about forgiving. And the second promise we hear is that not only is Jesus God, but that he will be with us, Emmanuel, that he is going to walk with you. So we're going to look at three points today that illustrate these three things. Here's the point of tonight's message. Jesus came to our place, earth, to take our place on the cross so that he could take us back to his place, his very presence. Let's walk through these. Jesus came to our place. Our world was dark, yet he was full of light. Let me ask you some more questions. When it comes to hospitality, how ready are you? And I think there are three different kinds of people. The first crowd is the people who are always ready. Your house is always clean. It's always immaculate. You always have some food in the fridge or something good to drink. And if someone stops by, you're not embarrassed. You're like, come on in. How many of you are in that crowd? Your house is always good to go for someone. Anybody? We got one, two. All right. Now, Kelly and I fall in this next crowd. Our house can ebb and flow throughout the week, but if we know you're coming over, we'll clean up, or at least the room that we know that you're going to be in, right? And we'll get ready to be hospitable for you. How many of you fall in that category? Okay. And there's a third category, and that's just people who straight up don't care. You live your life, and if they want to come over, just come on in. This is my life, my mess. Welcome to the party. How many of those do we have? We got a few. These are the party people. These are the for real people. All right. When Jesus came to our place in heaven, when he came from heaven to earth, we weren't that hospitable. We weren't ready. Basically, he was rejected as he was trying to love us. Why? Because the world was full of darkness. It started back in the Garden of Eden. Adam and Eve walked with God. It says they walked with him in the cool of the day. Adam and Eve, the very first people, they got to literally hang out with God in a special garden. And he told them, all this is yours. You can do whatever you want. This is, you have dominion over this. You can plant new trees. You can name the animals. Whatever you want, have fun in this garden. Enjoy it. And every day, we're just going to hang out. We're going to talk. We're going to walk. But they were told not to eat of the tree in the middle of the garden. And they did that very thing. The one who loved them most warned them, yet they trusted another who was out to deceive them. And he promised them, in the day you eat of this tree, you shall surely die. The life of God went out of them when they ate that fruit, and they began to die. Their hearts became cold, and the world entered into a place of darkness from that. And the world continued to get darker and darker. There's a story of a guy just a few chapters later in Genesis. His name's Lamech. And he's there and he's just boasting and bragging about violence. He's basically like, yeah, Cain, if you did something to him, he would get you back seven times, but I'm going to pay you back 70 times. So basically, if you stole a loaf of bread from him, he would burn down your house. He was just all about violence and getting you back, and might means right, and I'm going to take over the world. Well, we see the violence and darkness continues to grow in the people of God. God did miracle after miracle for his people. And then they came to this prophet and said, hey, you know what? We're done with God being our king. We want a king like everyone else. Give us a king to rule over us. And the brokenhearted prophet said, you don't want that. Don't give up on God as your king. And he warns them, if you take this earthly king, he's going to take your children and put them in the military. He's going to take of your fields and your grain. He's going to take your daughters and make them bakers and spray perfume upon him. And the prophet was basically saying, it won't be for God's glory anymore. It's going to be for this earthly king's glory. And they won't care about you or provide for you. And they're going to take from you to build up their own kingdom. And they said, in all fullness, give us that king instead of the God who loves us. And the world continued to spin in darkness. And every once in a while, a prophet would say something and it would spark light. Like in Isaiah chapter 7:14, a few hundred years later, after they rejected God as king, they said, this will be a sign for you. The virgin will conceive a child and the Holy Spirit will come upon her. And that was a little bit of light so that the people of God who still believed could keep moving forward. And as the Old Testament wrapped up, there was 400 years of silence and of darkness. And darkness began to reign. It was at this time Rome ruled the world. Caesar Augustus was the emperor of the world. And everywhere he went, he proclaimed not only that he was the ruler of the world, but he himself was a god. And this is the height of human pride, that not only do we commit violence, not only do we take from other people, we try to replace God as a human and say we ourselves are God, and he would make people worship and bow the knee to him as the Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And it was in this darkness that a baby was born and began to cry. And light filled our world. In the darkest part of our history, at the darkest time of men, where men are calling other men to worship themselves, a baby was born. Jesus came to our place. Just like it says in Galatians 4:4, when the set time had fully come, God sent his son, born of a woman, born under the law, to redeem those under the law so that we might receive adoption to sonship. Even though we weren't hospitable towards God, he came in the spirit of love. He came to redeem you. He came so that you could have life and life abundant. He came for you. But why did he come? Jesus took our place. There's this illustration this preacher named Robert Coleman shares. This boy had a disease, and this disease was fatal if it was not treated. And he fought through it, and he built up an immunity to the disease, and he was cured. But a couple years after him, his sister had the same disease. So the doctor pulled the little boy in a room, and he says, we need to do a blood transfusion if your sister wants a chance to make it. The little boy's lip began to quiver, and he began to shake. But he consented to the doctor for the blood transfusion. They wheeled his little sister in the room, and he became full of smiles, and he was happy again, and he was full of hope. The nurse came over to him, and they stuck the needle in his arm, and his countenance changed again, and he looked full of despair. And finally, he looked over at the doctor and said, how long until I die? What the doctor didn't know is that he thought a blood transfusion meant that he was going to die. But you see where his heart was. He was willing to trade his life so that his sister could live. He was willing to trade places with her so she could live. The doctor quickly told him, young man, you're not going to die, but your sister is going to live. Jesus takes our place. Jesus came to this earth so that he could trade places with you. How did he do that? He became nothing. The Bible says in Philippians 2:7, rather he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. The God who created everything became nothing. Look at how far he had to come. And not only when he come, when he got here, he had to continue to go through death. God put skin on. The very present you see hanging out in the lobby, all the presents you see around, the greatest present ever was Jesus Christ wrapped in love for you. I want you to think about it. He became touchable and approachable. Think about this. the one who is everywhere confined himself to a womb. The one who had all power became a helpless babe. He had to be fed and clothed and taught. The one who knew everything had to learn to read and write all again. He was literally everything, but he became nothing on your behalf. You sinned. We sinned. We exchanged the truth and glory of God for a lie. We went our own way, but he still came for us, and he traded places with us. And he went through the excruciating process of the cross. Listen to the sounds of the cross. Friends, those sobering sounds come from a God who wanted to trade places with you. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5, chapter 21, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. This is the greatest present exchange that has ever happened. You wrap up your whole life and put all of your sins, your guilt, and your shame, and you hand that box to him, and he hands you back himself, wrapped fully, fully full of love to forgive you and to walk beside you. Why? He became nothing so that you could become something, so that you could live up to your full potential, made in the image of God. The gift of Christmas is this: it's life. It's eternal life, that you get to live an eternal life as a child of God in the very presence of God. Why did he come to our place? Why did he take our place? Jesus did this to invite us back to his place. You see, the Bible tells us that God will always be with us. Heaven is living in the very presence of God. Now, when I think of presence, I think of my wife, because that's when I'm most myself. That's when I'm hanging out. I'm talking to her. And if she was sitting right here, we would have lots of discussions about lots of things. Our favorite time of the week is on Friday. The kids are at school, so the house is quiet. There's a day off. And we do things like we just hang out, we talk, we go to a coffee shop, or we run around from the day, or we work on a project together. And here lately, some old people stuff have crept up on us. Like, I'm kind of surprised at my own activities. If my dad heard this, I might not say it if he was still alive, because I'd be a little ashamed of this activity. But we even, like, this past Friday, she's like, I got us a special Christmas coffee for this Friday. I got really excited, and I couldn't wait to tear that apart. Then I felt embarrassed, like I was going to lose my man card for saying that out loud. But I love sitting in the presence of my wife to just talk, to laugh, to hang out, to be her friend. I want to remind you of the scripture where it says, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us. I want you to hear the gift of that. God wants to hang out with you. He wants to be your friend. He wants to walk beside you in every way. That's mesmerizing. That is joyful. That's hopeful. God wants to be your friend. He wants you to talk to him. He wants to hang out with you. He's interested in what you have to say. He's never mad or upset, and he's totally patient with you. I remember when I first got saved and God and I began to talk. I was in a crowd in a concert in Indianapolis. And my life was just full of debauchery, drugs, and alcohol, and just nothing good was going on in that time. And God spoke to me. He said, Wes, if you will go home, I'll do something with your life. And his presence became very real to me. And I followed that voice, and I began to listen to his presence. I began to interact, and his love came from this presence that he had. And I remember going to church for the first time and asking for the forgiveness of sins, and I could feel a literal weight come off my chest. And I was free for the first time because I was in his presence, and he was telling me how much he loved me, how much he cared for me, and what he was going to do and give me a purpose, a compass, a place to point my life and give it new direction. But you know, he doesn't just stop at salvation. The Bible gives us a very dear promise about his presence. It says in Hebrews 13:5, it says, keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said this, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. What a promise. Let's just be clear here. Let me ask you something. Men, how are you doing? Are you interacting with him? Is your life filled with confidence because you know that your Creator is with you? I know it's hard, the weight that you carry, whether you're single, whether you have a family, trying to work and trying to provide and all the things that culture wants you to do as a man, all the things that God requires of you. You feel stuck, you can feel stressed, whatever it is. But I want you to know, you can talk to God. That your challenges are not unique, but you're also not the only one who's struggling with that. He wants to hear from you. He wants to talk to you. He wants his presence to be unwrapped in your life. He doesn't want you to be angry. He wants to give you his peace that surpasses all understanding. But that only comes in a relationship. It only comes as you unwrap this at Christmas. Women, I won't be that direct with you because if I preach directly to women, I'll usually get corrected after the service, and it's Christmas, I don't want to do that, but just kidding. God desires for you women that he wants to fulfill the desires of your heart, that you have a longing in your heart that can only be fulfilled by God, and he wants to give you the self-esteem that you've always wanted. He wants to let you know that he's made you in his image in every way, that you don't have to live up to anyone else's expectation, that you are his daughter, you are a child of the king, and as you begin to discuss your life with him, that he will give you the courage, that he will give you the self-esteem, that he will take the desires of your heart, he will sanctify them, and your life can have more purpose than you ever dreamed. He loves you, and he loves hanging out with you. He loves hearing from your heart, and that's the beauty of his presence. I know for me that being a dad, being a pastor, feeling like you're always kind of falling short or you're disappointing someone during the week, whether it's your family, church, or never just having a clean week where you get it all right. I know that God is with me, and I know that his grace will prevail in my life every time. And even when I do fall short, he's there to tell me, dust yourself off, get back up, try again, don't give up. I'm here, I'm with you. Wes, I'm with you. And that comforts me on a daily basis. It doesn't stop there. Not only does his presence help us as we talk to him at salvation, it keeps us going on the daily, but listen to where the Bible ends up. This is forever talking to Jesus. Revelation 21, verses 3 through 4. This is what should help you put one foot in front of the other with joy. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. Now here's where it gets personal. God is going to reach over one day, and it says, he will wipe away every tear from their eyes. He knows you've been hurt. He cares for you. He's not mad at you. He wants to touch the very tears from you. He promises you there will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away. Friends, you will see God face to face. What a day. Can you imagine all this gone and God is here in his presence again, full, you see him face to face, and all he does is want to hang out with you forever. What a beautiful thing. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you for coming. Thank you for trading places so that you could take us back to your place. God, we want to live in your presence forever. And God, we thank you that Christmas was the beginning of all of that. that when you broke into this darkness and when that baby cried, it echoed grace and forgiveness for everyone, and all of us can cling to the promise that you will be with us forever. God, we want to thank you for that. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. As you come in here tonight, on your seat, there was a response card. And it just says, how will you respond? And it's got one box. Today, I received the gift of Jesus Christ for the first time. I wonder how many of you feel a calling in your heart tonight. Yes, I want to give my life to Christ. I'm thankful that he came. I'm thankful that he traded places with me, and I want to spend the rest of my life being in his presence. What we're going to do now is watch a video that summarizes the sermon, and we're going to sing a worship song. I would just ask over these next few moments if you would pray and think about responding tonight. Is God calling you to accept Jesus as the Savior, to become a child of God tonight for the first time? Watch this video with me.
Why?
Why?
Why did Jesus come to earth?
Why forsake the majesty and fellowship of heaven?
Exchanging a palace for a stable.
Immortal comforts for a feeding trough.
And robes of glory for the feeble body of an infant.
An unparalleled irony, this supreme, unrivaled nobility experiencing absolute and total humility.
Our sovereign God, Emmanuel, as a baby.
He didn't come to heap shame upon sinners or to judge and cast out the impious, but to break bread with those called unrighteous.
He didn't come to illuminate every mystery of the cosmos or to enlighten the intellectual, but to fulfill the testimony of prophets clothed in rags.
He didn't come to elevate a single nation or to advocate a particular political affiliation. He came because he saw you, broken, in need of salvation.
He saw you lost and abandoned, crying out, surrounded by deaf ears, fighting through the tears, but beaten down by the torments of this world.
And unable to bear your distress, he renounced his eternal throne,
walked the earth,
bore the stripes,
accepted the nails,
and gave up his last breath,
so that you could receive the breath of life.
Our holy, infinite God
beheld your pain,
perceived your heart,
and determined that your soul was worth dying for.
From the manger to the cross to the empty tomb,
it is all a story of profound love, of a Savior who rescued his children from darkness,
of a blameless king who declared that no sacrifice was too great for the sake of his beloved creation.
Why did Jesus come to earth?
He came for you.
Oh, holy night, the stars are
Everlasting presence. Tonight he wants to forgive your sins. He wants you to have a fresh start over. He wants you to experience grace, unmerited favor upon your life. If you feel God is calling you to do that, you can pull out this card and you can check that. At the back of our worship centers, you're going to find some tables on your way out. There's some people there that have a box in a new believer's Bible, and they would love to give you that gift as you start out a new spiritual journey. If you're watching online, you can just type in, I would love to give my life to Christ. I would love to receive Jesus for the first time, and your online host will walk you through that. Lady Smith, there will be someone at the front or at the back of the room to lead you to Christ if you want to make that decision tonight. Friends, there's no greater joy than being in the presence of God, where you can find his love, wholeness, joy, and watch his love cast out all fear out of your heart. He loves you very deeply. For the rest of us, for those who are believers, when Jesus came in this world, he said, I am light of the world. And then later he would teach us, not only was he light of the world, he was going to fill us with that light, and he tells us we are the light of the world. We are a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. We are going to boldly proclaim as we light these candles. We know that he came for us. We know that he traded places with us, that we were the condemned criminals, but he took our place and set us free as the children of God so that we could live in his presence forever. If the ushers would come forward and begin to take their places, they're going to light your candles. If your candle is the one lit, hold it up like that, and the person who's not lit so the wax doesn't get everywhere or burn someone's hands, but we are going to boldly stand up and proclaim the joy of Christmas, that Jesus came so that we could unwrap his presence. Would you begin and continue to worship with us?
Pray that as we continue throughout our night tonight with our families and with Christmas tomorrow, that we can continue to adore him and to remember why we are celebrating this season. You can all extinguish your candles. I want to remind you one more time about next weekend. We have our online-only New Year's services. You don't want to miss those. You can get your family all together, huddled up on the couch as we join in those services together, worshiping from home. And the following weekend, we're going to have our transforming series kicking off, all about the transforming power that God has in our lives. You're not going to want to miss those testimonies. If you gave your life to Christ tonight, if you made the decision to follow him for the first time, first of all, I want to say welcome to the family. And congratulations on making the best decision you will ever make in your life. We are so proud of you for that. If you did not make that decision, for the rest of us, as you're heading out tonight, you can drop your candles in the baskets by the door. But if you did make that decision tonight, stop at one of the tables on the way out. We would love to connect with you and give you a new believer's box filled with a Bible and talk to you about next steps. You can all head out to the lobby, enjoy your meat sticks, your cheese, your fudge, and your hot chocolate. And I hope you have a very Merry Christmas.
stand amazed. I'm staring at an empty grave and the stone that you rolled away. I was a prodigal, you saw the sun. When I left the 99, you saw the one. And just like that, all my past has been erased. When I look back, I see grace. I see grace. Grace, oh grace. Grace that is greater than all my sin.
All my disguises have kept me away, 'cause sometimes it's easier to hide than show my shame. All of the letdowns, every mistake, are starting to make me feel I'm too far gone to save. You see the worst in me, but you love me all the same. I can't be honest with you about anything. Even the pain behind a million scars couldn't begin to change who you are. So I'm not afraid to let down my guard, 'cause you are my candid heart. No hesitation, I'm risking it all. Knowing you're catching all my pieces as they fall. It's all I